And Resurrection Sunday, what we call Easter Sunday, is an amazing season. This is a season of victory, so we worship the Lord. We praise Him and we glorify Him. We thank Him for what He did at the cross. We thank Him for the far He's brought us. Lord, we want to say thank you so much. Thank you for that cross, Lord. Thank you for that blood that was shed. Thank you for the grace that located us and found us and saved us. Thank you for resurrection, that you did not only die for us, but you resurrected. Because you are alive, we are alive in you, O God. Because you resurrected, we shall also resurrect, O God. So, Father, we thank you for resurrection power. We thank you for the excitement of living with you. Thank you for the excitement that we are in right standing with you, O God. So we glorify your name. We give you praise. We give you glory. We give you honor, Lord. Honor that is due your name, O God. We thank you and we bless you in Jesus' name we've prayed. Amen and amen and amen. Amen. Hallelujah. How many of you are excited about Easter? Give a shout to the Lord. Yeah, give a shout, a loud shout to the Lord. Hallelujah. You may take your seats. Our time is fast spent. Take your seats. You've missed the fun we had during the first service. We had so much fun. Oba tubaweko sambo. Tubaweko sambo. Hey, katino basi tukenga namwe ba mukomamu. They are not happy. But okay, but you like your finished work of the cross, we shall be in heaven. You're not going to stay here. We were made for the earth, yes, but we are going home. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. I bring you greetings from Pastor Bernard. He says, Happy Easter. Yes, he's well. He's about to come back. Give God the glory. Hallelujah. Today I'm going to talk about justification, sanctification, and glorification. Many of us are saved, but we see those terms and we don't understand what is justification, what is sanctification, what is glorification. Amen. So today we are going to speak about those three terms. Our God is good. Hallelujah. We are saved. It's the most exciting thing. Amen. We are saved. We are born again. I'm so grateful to God. I've been born again for 37 years. Older than some of you, double your age. Hallelujah. And the Lord is the most amazing thing in my life. My marriage is amazing, but the Lord is the most amazing thing. My kids are incredible, but the Lord is the most amazing thing. There are so many incredible things, but salvation is the best thing that ever happened to me. Amen. The Lord, in the Lord, there is fullness of everything. Everything, everything, everything I need. Hallelujah. Everything I can ever be. Amen. All the promotion I want is in the Lord. Hallelujah. But today we are going to talk about justification and sanctification and glorification. What happens when we become believers? And you might be here and you're not born again. Today you have an opportunity to be born again. Amen. Because as we are going to heaven, we are going to be excited. And it doesn't matter how much you believe, whether heaven or hell are there. They are there. They don't depend on your belief. They are set. Amen. There's an actual place. There's an actual place we are going. There is this belief, oh no, heaven is the good things you experience here. That is part of it. We are going to a place. We are going to a place whose streets are made of gold, where our bodies will no longer be sick. We are going to a place where we are going to have a new body. Amen. We are going to a place where we are going to be renewed, and we are going to live forever and ever and ever and ever. You know, distance in our vernacular is counted in the tone of voice. We are going far. When we are going to Prayer Mountain, man, the usual road had problems. So we had to go through a trading center called Tongolo. But when they are directing you, when you take off the Maram, it's still the Maram, to take the other Maram road, they tell you, you're going to Tongolo, but it is far, then you know, it is not near. It is far, but we are going to live forever. I cannot even do that one, amen. But how and where we will live forever depends on the choice we make today. Amina, it does not depend on the prayers we'll say when we are sending you off. Does not matter how much, whether we do an overnight for a whole month. It will not change where your destiny. Today is the day of salvation. So today I'm going to talk about three phases of our salvation. And if you've never given your life to Christ, I want you to begin to make room. I want you to begin to think about these things. And one of the first steps of our salvation is justification. Justification. And I want us to read from, let's first read that scripture. We're going to look at justification, but please give me Romans 3, 24 to 26 in the Amplified Version, because it expands it a bit so that you understand that scripture. Romans 3, 24 to 26 in the Amplified Version. All right. Our stuff is a little slow, but be patient with us. I want us to read it in the Amplified so that we're good. Okay, but I don't see it where I want to see it. All are justified and made upright and in right standing with God, freely and gratuitously. But this Amplified, nayo nongo semo, my Amplified doesn't have gratuitously. Freely and gratuitously by His grace, His unmerited favor and mercy, through redemption which is provided in Christ Jesus. Verse 25, whom God put forward before the eyes of all as a mercy seat and propitiation by His blood, the cleansing and life-giving sacrifice of atonement and reconciliation. That word propitiation is the process of appeasing a deity or appeasing a God who is angry. That word propitiation means there is a deity, there is a God that is angry and needs to be appeased. Do you get what I mean? And from that process of propitiation is where the atonement, Christ had to atone for us. Christ had to die for us to atone for the wrath of God to be appeased, because the wages of sin is death. So the lamb had to be slain to cleanse a life-giving sacrifice of atonement and reconciliation to be received through faith. This was to show God's righteousness because in his divine forbearance he had passed over and ignored former sins without punishment. Hallelujah. Amen. So that word is very, very important. Give us verse 26. Verse 26. I hope I can read it from in front there. It was to demonstrate and prove the present time in the now season that he himself is righteous and that he justifies and accepts as righteous him who has true faith in Jesus. Hallelujah. So justification is a one-time event and it occurs when we receive salvation and enter into a relationship with Christ. Amen. Justification occurs when God frees us from the penalty of sin. All of us have sinned and fallen short of the glory of the Lord. Amen. But because of the finished work, because of Christ, the atoning sacrifice, we are free from the penalty of sin. That is justification. In a moment, we were declared righteous because of the sinless, perfect life of Christ. We did not earn that. Amen. And we can't earn it for ourselves. We can't earn it in our own righteousness. Isaiah 64, verse 6. We can use the New King James Version or whatever. We don't have to use the Amplified. But Isaiah 64, 6. This is what Isaiah 64, 6 says. For all of us have become like one who is unclean, and all our righteous deeds are like filthy garment. In other versions, they are like filthy rugs. And all of us wither like a leaf, and our iniquities like the wind take us away. So when we had sinned, the Bible says that while we were yet sinners, Christ died for us, and he justified us. And through justification, the penalty of sin has been eternally eliminated. Christ does not keep dying as people are getting saved. We have been justified. Justification is about freeing us from the penalty of sin. Today we are singing, Yakolachi, Yanaza. Yanaza no musaigwe. The Bible says that we believe in our hearts and we confess with our mouth to have salvation, unto salvation. Amen? So in justification, when we believe in our hearts and we confess with our mouths, we are justified. It is a one-time event. We are justified. Our penalty for sin is paid for by the blood of the sinless Lamb of God, by the blood of the sinless perfect Son of God. Amen? Then we enter the stage of sanctification. We have been justified, but yet we have been sanctified, but we are also being sanctified. Amen? The Bible says that he who overcomes shall be saved. So sometimes people say, but I'm saved. Then why does the scripture say that he who overcomes shall be saved? Do you get what I mean? I have been saved by faith, by grace through faith. Amen. I've been saved by grace, the unmerited favor. I didn't have to fast. I didn't have to whatever. I was walking around. I was in my house. I was sleeping. God encountered me. Maybe he encountered me in a dream. Maybe somebody preached to me. Maybe I had heard it in Sunday school. And as I was growing up, that day dawned on me. And I said, but I believe in my heart. And by his unmerited favor, by his grace, through faith, I confess Christ and I'm justified. But after I'm justified, I need to be sanctified. And sanctification is the process of setting a person or a thing apart for its intended design. When I'm driving my car, it is sanctified because it is being driven. It was made to be driven. Amen? So we are sanctified. People are sanctified. And we are used for the purpose God intended. God didn't intend us to serve sin. God intended us to live sinless. That was his purpose. So the sanctification process is about setting us apart back to the intended design. Amen. And in sanctification, Christ frees us from the power of sin. In justification, Christ frees us from the penalty of sin. Do we understand the difference? We are beginning to understand. The sanctification process, Christ gives us the power over sin. We have power over sin. Amen. In our everyday lives, we are being sanctified. We are sanctified. There is provision for it. Justification, the penalty of sin, was dealt with. Sanctification, we have freedom from the power of sin. I'll read 1 Thessalonians chapter 5. We are being changed. We are set apart for design. Amen. For God's intended purpose. Don't be too bored. This is the most important news for us as believers. Amen. 1 Thessalonians chapter 5, verse 23. Now may the God of peace himself sanctify you entirely, and may your spirit and soul and body be preserved complete without blame at the coming of our Lord Jesus Christ. Amen. Our spirit, soul, and body is meant to be preserved blameless. These days we have excuses. You know, when we get saved during justification, our spirit, the Holy Spirit comes and sits in our spirit. We have been saved. Our body does not get saved. But the process of sanctification says that we are being sanctified, that our spirit, soul, and body be presented blameless. Blameless. Our body is supposed to be presented blameless. We have power in Christ to overcome sin. We have not been left helpless to our libido. Oh, I can't do anything about it. You know, I have secondary characteristics. The hormones, we are not helpless. Our bodies are supposed to be presented blameless. The bodies don't get saved, our spirit gets saved. But as the Holy Spirit continues to sanctify us, our spirit, soul, and body is meant to be presented blameless. Amen? By the Lord Jesus Christ, amen? Let me read for you a scripture in Romans. It wasn't part of, but when we were worshiping God, this scripture came to me, Romans 6. I'm going to read from verse 12. To verse something. Romans 6, verse 12. Therefore, do not let sin reign in your mortal body so that you may not obey its lusts. It's you. They're saying, therefore, do not let sin reign. Why would we be told not to let sin reign if we are powerless? We would absolutely be powerless against sin. But in sanctification, it has been provided for. We've been freed from the power of sin. We are no longer slaves to sin. And Romans 6, 12 says, therefore do not let sin reign in your mortal body so that you may obey its lusts. And do not go on presenting the members of your body to sin as instruments of unrighteousness. Do not keep on presenting the members of your body, presenting your mouth, presenting your hands, presenting your legs, presenting those other parts, the soft ones. During COVID, they told us not to touch the soft parts. But the Bible is telling us, do not present the members of your body to sin as instruments of unrighteousness. But present, it even tells us what we ought to do. But present yourselves to God as those alive from the dead, as members, and your members as instruments of righteousness to God. For sin shall not be master over you. Sin cannot be our master because there is provision. The sanctification process, we are being sanctified. We were justified. The penalty of our sin was paid for. But now we are free from the power of sin. Tell yourself, I'm free from the power of sin. By the blood of Jesus, by the atoned, you know, that sacrifice by Calvary. I'm being sanctified. I have power against sin. I shouldn't present my members to be used for sin that leads to unrighteousness. Hallelujah. Sanctification is a process. God is working in our lives to conform us to the image of Christ. Every time we tell you, this pulpit says that our standard is Christ. We are not going to read 2 Corinthians 3:18 because it was our theme scripture for a whole year. But it says that we are being transformed, we are being changed from glory to glory into the image of God, of His Son Jesus Christ. Christ is the standard. The sanctification process is what takes us from justification. By grace through faith, I have become a believer. The penalty for my sin has been destroyed. Now I'm walking, being an imitator of God, conforming to the likeness of Christ. That is a process. Amen. And I get to submit to the process. You and me, we get to submit. It is not imparted. We submit to the process. We decide, I will not make the members of my body instruments for sin. Hallelujah. Why? Because there is provision. There is grace. Grace is not only unmerited favor. Grace is divine enablement to overcome sin. Amen. To overcome, to be changed, our character to be changed so that we look like Christ. Sanctification begins when we are justified, and it continues until we are complete in Christ, until we go to glory. Until the day you die, you're being sanctified. Hence the scriptures that say, he who overcomes will be saved. So you're wondering, I have been saved. They've said in church, I'm saved. Or the person who met me and preached the gospel to me said, I'm saved. Yes, I'm justified. The penalty of my sin has been broken. But now I'm walking as one who has been freed from the power of sin. Amen. Amen. We walk. That is sanctification. We are being changed. We are being set apart from sin for our original purpose and design and intent. Amen. God designed that we live in perfect harmony with Him. So justification, we have been washed. The penalty has been paid for. So we are in right standing with God. And after we are in right standing with God, then we are in the sanctification process, overcoming the power of sin, being changed into the likeness of Christ. Amen. Then one day, the glorification has been purchased. But this is that day where we shall live free from the presence of sin. Oh, what a day. We'll read 1 John 3:2. My heart longs for that day sometimes. Sometimes it longs for it as if I want to escape. But other times it's so exciting to imagine. To imagine, to behold the one we have loved, the one we have talked about, the one we have marveled about, the one we have sung about, the one music has been written about and you cannot exhaust him. People have written music. They are singers. They are groups. They are whatever. We have tried to explain who this person is, but the Bible says that one day we will be glorified. 1 John 3 verse 2 says, beloved, now we are children of God, and it has not appeared as yet what will be. But we know that when He appears, we will be like Him, because we will see Him just as He is. Hallelujah. It's the fulfillment of our salvation, the end of our Christian journey. When we are leaving the earth and we are going to be glorified, and we will have a glorified body. The backaches will be no more. The short vision or long one, correcting of vision, will be no more. Cancer will be no more. We will live in free from the presence of sin, no temptation. Oh, no enticement. Our faith will be sight. What we just believed will be sight. One day we will see Him. I want you to close your eyes and just imagine that day. Oh, one day we will see the one we have loved, the one we have followed, the one who is unsearchable, the one who is inexhaustible. Oh, the one who does not change. Oh, hallelujah. There is a song and I'm going to sing it for you as you meditate. If you know it, you can sing where you are. If you don't know it, it's okay. That on that day we will sing, holy, holy. On that day we'll bow down in the light. Then we'll rise and turn eyes to the Lord, who's the light, the light of that city. On that day we will sing, holy, holy. On that day we'll bow down in the light. Then we will rise and turn our eyes to the Lord, who's the light, the light of that city. Can you imagine? The Bible says Jesus is the light of that city. We don't need lights. There will be no umeme. Jesus is the light of that city. He will light up that city. We will cross the pearly gates and our bodies will be changed. And we will join the angels, we will join the elders, and we will turn our eyes and we shall fix them on Jesus. And we will say, this is the one we loved. This is the one who loved us first. This is the one who paid the penalty of sin. This is the one who gave us the grace to overcome the power of sin. And here we are. I can't imagine being in a sin-free zone. It's a hard thing to imagine, but that is glorification. And we shall live with the Lord forever and ever and ever and ever. Many of us have different stories. Every time I say, then you think, I'll talk to John. When they threw you in the boiling pot of oil and you didn't die and you were thrown in the island of Patmos, what were you thinking? And then I think, I don't know whether we'll have a lot of time for Wolokoso. But the other day I was reading the book of Revelation. Then I discovered we shall sing the song of Moses. Because in heaven they are singing the song of Moses. You know, there's a song in Exodus, but then you find it in Revelation. I have such a wild imagination. And for me, when I sing that song I was singing, I was so emotional that on that day, we will bow down to the light. Oh, and we will rise up and turn our eyes to the Lamb, to the Lord who is the light of that city. We can't fathom, we can't have those things in our minds. They only bubble in our spirit. We long for heaven. Your spirit longs to connect with the Lord. Your spirit longs for a place where there is no sin. And together, the justification, the sanctification, the glorification, all together, us who are lost, now are part of the family of God. Hallelujah. Us who are lost, we are going to spend eternity. Children of God, eternity is real. The Bible says that one day we are going to come before the judgment seat of Christ. And the books will be opened. And another book will be opened. And the Lord will separate. You know, there is a separation of the sheep and the goats. Friends, today as we speak about this thing, just imagine you're a parent and your child ends up on the goat side and you end up on the sheep. For eternity, we'll be separated forever. and the goats will go to hell. They will live in hell for eternity. This thing is not for a moment. It is for eternity, and we shall live with the Lord for eternity. The sheep and the goats will be separated. And the Bible says, then are the books. You know, for us who are in right standing with Christ, ours will not be judgment for sin. But the Bible says that, you know, because of the things we did. When you read the scriptures, you're thinking, man, there are going to be some people. They will be in heaven, but munange, they will be, eh? Yes. And then the books will be opened. And then every man, their work will be presented. And everyone will be rewarded based on what they did, not on what Christ did. That is, the penalty of sin has been paid for. But we are walking. We shall be glorified. There is a day of reckoning. There is a day of rewards. If you have unsaved loved ones, you want to be praying for them. Oh, that day when your mother is the other side and you're this side. One day we were at Haggai Institute for our leadership for evangelism training. And this lady from Kazakhstan, you know, they are not teaching us to be leaders, but they are teaching us to use our leadership to evangelize. And then, we were there for 3 weeks, but in the middle of our course, something hit her. We had finished the day's training, and we were out of the training rooms in the corridors, so we were with one of our faculty, and were about three of us. And she ran out of the training room and came and told us, "You people, do you mean my mother is going to hell and burn in hell?" Do you know how somebody asks a question and none of you is brave enough to say? And our faculty looked at us. The faculty wasn't going to say anything, but let me tell you something. We were powerless to say anything. It is very difficult to some. All of us can never know. You get what I mean? We really don't know the person's final end. But we know that there is one way to God. And we know Jesus Christ is his name. Amen? And we know the Bible has told us enough that unless you're born again, you will not see the kingdom of heaven. And we have loved ones who are not born again. It is very difficult to tell your friend that their mother will spend eternity gnashing teeth, burning and not being consumed, and feeling the pain of hell. But that's not the news I brought today. The news today I brought, we've been justified. Amen? And we are being sanctified. And one day we shall be glorified. Amen? And this is what happens. Justification is free. Sanctification is costly. Amen? The Bible says we pick our cross. Some of you say, "Don't tell me those are works, those are works." I'm going to tell you something. The penalty of sin has been paid for. None of us paid anything to be born again. We didn't fast, we didn't do anything. We received the free gift. Amen? And we believed in our hearts and we confessed with our mouth and were given salvation. But after that, we walk with the Lord, and it is costly to walk with the Lord. Justification is instantaneous. Sanctification is a lifelong process. If you want the notes, liaise with the media people, they have the notes. Justification is by faith. Sanctification is of works. What do I mean? Let's read that scripture, Philippians 2. You might think, "Atema miyagambe tu ino kukole rero bulokozi." No, we are justified, but also there is this scripture here, Philippians 2, 12 to 13 says, "So then, my beloved, just as you have always obeyed, not as in my presence only, but now much more in my absence, work out your salvation with fear and trembling. For it is God who is at work in you, both to will and to work for his good pleasure." God is working in us, but the only way we become sanctified is when we cooperate with that work. Amen? We are washed by the word, but the word has to be read. How many of you know reading the word can be tedious? Making time to read the word, making time to do the word, being bold and courageous to do the word is work. It's not by faith. We don't do the word by faith. Our faith has actions. Amen? Justification involves God's love for us. Sanctification involves my love for Christ that is demonstrated by obeying all he has said. Amen? by faith he has loved me, he justifies me, I'm born again, but now I reciprocate my love by following Christ. Amen. Following Christ is followed in action, in decisions, in choices. Hallelujah. Justification concerns Christ's righteousness. Sanctification concerns us giving up our lives for Christ. Everyone, Luke 14, those verses 25 to 33 says, everyone should count the cost. Amen? And then you pick up your cross daily and you follow Christ. Hallelujah! Amen! Justification requires obedience to one command. You receive the free gift of salvation. You believe in your heart. You confess with your mouth unto salvation. Hallelujah. Sanctification requires obedience to all that Christ has commanded. Amen. Amen. Matthew 28:19 says that we are going into the whole world to make disciples of all nations, teaching them to obey everything. Teaching them to obey everything. Hallelujah. Those two things are different. Justification focuses on the cross which Christ took upon us for once and for all. Hebrews 7:27 says, he died for all once and for all. He does not need to die again. That's why Hebrews 6 tells us that he cannot pay that price again. He cannot crucify. So when you keep sinning, it's as if you're crucifying him again. But he did it for all, once and for all. But sanctification focuses on the cross, that I take it up daily. I'm not once saved, always saved. Hallelujah. Our inner man is saved. I'm going to read for you a scripture as we end today, and you will see what I'm talking about. Justification is finished at the moment of faith. Sanctification is not finished until I go to be with the Lord. Amen? Amen? That is where now the Spirit of God that sits in your spirit is influencing your soul, that is being fed on the Word of God, to present your body blameless. Do you remember the scripture? So spirit, soul, and body, we are supposed to be presented blameless. Friends, let's stop giving excuses for sin. We are not powerless. Jesus said that it's good for me to go, that I send you the Holy Spirit. He will remind you of all things. We have power to overcome sin. We have power to overcome gossip, to overcome unforgiveness, to overcome every filth. We have power to separate ourselves. Sanctification, we separate ourselves from the world. We are in the world, but we are not of the world. Hallelujah. That is sanctification. So what is happening during justification? What is the role of God in our justification? By the way, the role of God as we are getting saved, he was judge. He was ready to punish sin. The wages of sin is death. But his wrath was appeased by the blood of Jesus, by the atonement. So for us in the sanctification process, he's a cleanser. He washes us with the water of the word. Hallelujah. He's the gardener that prunes us so that we bear much more fruit. He's the Holy Spirit that is our help, our paraclete, who walks alongside us, cleansing us and purifying us day by day, helping us to transform our minds. Amen? And what is the work of God at justification? A single act of saving you. But during sanctification, there is a continued work with the Holy Spirit. Amen? What is the result of the believer? Once we get saved, we are justified. We are in right standing with God. We can come to the Holy of Holies. Amen? We are in right standing. We go before the throne of grace of God with boldness. And we obtain mercy and favor. Hallelujah. But what is the result for us on earth? We are in a certain state. We are being cleansed. There we are in right standing. But now we are working out our salvation. Hallelujah. What is the nature of work? It was objective. It was done for us at justification. But during sanctification, we do the work. Let me tell you something. The Holy Spirit will not change you against your will. That's why we're always submitting before the will of God. That's why we go to divine encounter and say, Lord, We are here separated for these 2 days. Have a work in us that whatever is in our spirit, we will quieten our flesh enough that it bubbles up. And hopefully it can consume us and we can be consumed with the zeal of the Lord. Amen. That we'll be filled. We have a work to surrender, to open the Bible, to read it, to do it. That work is not done for us, but it's done with the help of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Amen. And then what's the degree of work we do when we are being justified? Nothing. We believe in our hearts and we confess. Hallelujah. But that degree of work we do during sanctification is progressive. As he removes this, as he sets you apart from that, as he tells you come out from among them and be ye separate, as he tells you this and the other, as he tells you to get off TikTok, as he tells you to get off WhatsApp, as he tells you to get off Instagram, as he tells you to silence things, as he tells you to choose another thing, it is progressive. Hallelujah. In justification, what changed? Relationship. In sanctification, God is practical. Amen. God is not a magician. He does not wave magic winds for us to grow. We mature by choice. I told you maturity is not imparted. There is no amount of singing about the Holy Spirit that can change your life unless you submit and work with the Holy Spirit. There is no amount of jumping in church that can sanctify you. After jumping, you operate in what you've been jumping. When the demons are terrorizing you, then you remember, Yanaza, Yanaza. Then you Yanaza in your house. Don't just kunaza ring in the church. Hallelujah. Amen. God is practical. We have the power over sin because he's freed us from the power of sin. And he continues to free us from the power of sin. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Children of God. Those are the phases of our salvation. We are justified. We are sanctified, glorified. I don't know what is going on in your life today, but you may be here and you've never given your life to Christ. I want to give you an opportunity to be justified this afternoon. I want to give you that rare, amazing, beautiful opportunity. I was 16 years old. I was a little Catholic girl. I used to be an altar girl. In my primary school, it was a single girl's school. I was an altar girl. And then I went to a single sex school and I was an altar girl. And I remember it was a Sunday. I kind of know the dress I was wearing. I had a brown suit. I was an altar girl. We were done, but revival had broken out in our school. I always honored Dr. Joan. She's now a vet doctor who brought revival in our school. She was preaching for a number of weeks. And that day when I left, after we've kept away the things we use for mass, I told my friend, but let's go and listen to that. What's happening, the revival? I forget, was it the chemistry lab or the physics lab? But we went. And Joan preached. And Joan made an altar call. And I remember myself coming out, 1985. Many of you here were not born, and I stood in the middle of that place with other people. I want to testify that so many of the faces I remember in that season of revival in our school, they are still serving the Lord. They are walking with the Lord. The Lord is faithful. We were young, but the Lord has kept us. Now I have a child who is older than the age I gave my life to Christ at. God is faithful, and I came and gave my life to Christ. So you might be here and you've never given your life to Christ. I want to give you an opportunity. We are not ashamed of the gospel, for it's the power of God unto salvation. And if you want to give your life to Christ and be justified, I want you to raise your hand. If you want to give your life to Christ, those of you who are born again, this is a good moment to pray for loved ones who are not born again. This is a good time to name them, to say, Lord, save my uncle, save my aunt, my grandmother, my mother, my father. Lord, let your power be quickened to them. Visit them, encounter them. Bring a person with the good news. After here, I might call them. I might ask them to be born again. You might want to be saved. If you want to be born again, I want you to lift up your hand. Okay, all of us seem to be born again. I want to draw you, us who are born again. I want to read this scripture and I want everyone to look at me. So in 1985, when I got born again, I didn't have any discipleship or anyone because the school we're in. It was even a miracle that there was revival because that was not permitted. Then I switched schools and I met these girls that came from another school and they were born again. And we started waking up to go to pray 5 a.m. in the class. Would not switch on any lights. It was dark, 1989. All those friends of mine are also still believers. Oh, glory to God for His grace and His mercy. Because there are many people who have fallen away from the faith. We were young. We were A-levels by that time and would go to this. No, we're not A-levels. At first, we were still O-levels. Then we transitioned. But anyway, we would go to these classrooms and not turn on the lights, 5 a.m. And we would pray. We didn't even know how to pray, but we would talk to God whichever way we wanted. And I remember our prayers usually were based on, God, use us. We are here, save us. We didn't even know. We were not praying to be pastors. We didn't have anything specific, but we just knew that we needed God and God needed to use us. And I remember one morning we sang this song and my inner man was revived. I have decided to follow Jesus. I have decided to follow Jesus. I have decided to follow Jesus. No turning back, no time. By the grace of God, I've never turned back. I've made many mistakes. I have been reluctant, I have been lazy, but I've never turned back. But child of God, you're saved and you're here. I want to read this scripture. And Patrick, I want everyone to be silent as you hear this scripture. Because some of us believe that we are okay, but I want you to hear Revelation chapter 3. And I'm going to read from verse 1 to 6. I don't want you to move. I don't want you to be whatever. Revelations chapter 3. These were messages to the different churches. But you hear this message to the church of Sardis. To the angel of the church in Sardis write, He who has the seven spirits of God and the seven stars says this, I know your deeds, that you have a name that you're alive, but you're dead. Children of God, some of us have a name. We've been dancing this morning and shouting, He called my name and I ran out of the grave. We have a name or we have a persona like we are alive, but dead. Then he says in verse 2, wake up and strengthen the things that remain, which are about to die. I don't know who you are today. But you need to wake up, you need to arise, you need to strengthen the things that are about to die. For I have not found your deeds completed in the sight of my God. Friends, there is a completion. Yes, we've been justified, but he's warning them and telling them. So remember what you have received and had and keep it. Bible y'Oluganda egamba nyweza. Oba mu Luganda nsobola gamba nyweza. So remember what you have received and heard and keep it and repent. Repent, change your mind. Turn around. Friends, I don't want people moving up and down. Okay? If we are not dying too much, we can still wait in this moment. Amen. Therefore, if you do not wake up, I will come like a thief, and you will not know at what hour I will come to you. But you have a few people in Sardis who have not soiled their garments. God always has a remnant. God always has a remnant, and I want you to be part of the remnant. Amen. And they will walk with me in white, for they are worthy. Verse 5. He who overcomes will thus be clothed in white garments, and I will not erase his name from the book of life. It is possible, based on this scripture, for your name to be erased from the book of life. When I was a young believer, before I chanced on this, I used to think, my name is written in the Lamb's book of life, I'm sorted. Until I read this scripture. We are many born again people today, and we have a name that we are alive, yet we are dead. The Bible is telling us, wake up. Remember what you were taught. Remember what you received and keep it. Strengthen what has not yet died. And if you do not strengthen it, you will not be worthy to be in the white garment. And I will erase your name from the book of life. These are not my words, friends. And nayabamba dengo yezo. He says, I will not erase. Amen. There is an eraser. There is a rubber. There is a possibility that you can actually be erased. Amen. But he's reminding us today, he loves us so much. He says, I will not erase his name from the book of life. And I will confess his name before my Father and before the angels. And he who has an ear, let him hear what the Spirit says. I want you to rise up. We have a name. We are alive yet dead. They call you Mulokole. The Bible says that many will come to me and say, Lord, Lord, we cast out demons in your name. We prophesied. We gave to the hungry. We made the lame walk. We sang. People danced. Then he will say, get away from me because I never knew you. There is a possibility. You start praying. Hallelujah. There is a possibility of having a name of being alive yet dead. Of jumping the highest in church yet dead. Of coming for every connect group yet dead. Coming for every event yet dead. Tithing yet dead. But we have hope in Jesus. Hallelujah. Right now is a good name to lift up your hands and say, Jesus, Son of David, have mercy on me. I've been justified. Jesus died to free us from the penalty of sin. Jesus died to free us from the power of sin. And one day he'll lead us to the Father, and we will be free from the presence of sin. My Lord, we want to be ready. I want to be ready. This is an individual prayer. You will not stand with your husband. You will not stand with. This is the time when we will all stand. We will not come as a family. We will not come with your grandmother. You'll stand alone. Oh, we want to be ready, Lord. We want to strengthen that which we've learned. We want to strengthen that which we believed. We want to keep, we want to repent, to change our minds, to change our perspective. We are in the world, but we are not of the world. We ask the fire of the Holy Spirit that is in our bellies, that is in our spirit, to burn every carnality. A carnal-minded man will not see the kingdom of heaven. The Bible says a coward will not see the kingdom of heaven. We have no excuse for fear. You cannot say, me, I was afraid, then I buried the talent. Fear is no excuse in the grandness of that moment. That day will be grand. But you see, you do not achieve anything after death. You do it now. This is a time to surrender to the Holy Spirit, to the working of the Holy Spirit, to the separation of the Holy Spirit. Oh, we surrender to you, Lord. We We surrender to your voice. We surrender to your word. We surrender to instruction. We surrender to your grace by which we have been saved. We rejoice in that finished work. Ephesians 5 tells us, be imitators of God. Today we choose to be imitators. Whether we work in a secular setting, we are there as ambassadors of Christ. We are separated. We don't have unholy mixtures. The danger of the body of Christ today, we have unholy mixtures. Holiness means being set apart. We are set apart, but we mix. When your family gathers for sorcery and witchcraft, you're part of them. You've believed the tradition of men, traditions taught by men, that you need to appease the gods of your fathers, the gods of your ancestors. So you mix things. Unholy mixtures. You need to separate yourself. Come out from among them and be separate, says the Lord. Conversations. The Bible says that nothing we take defiles a man, but whatever comes out of us is what defiles us. From the fullness of the heart, the mouth speaks. Lord, we surrender our hearts to you, that our hearts will be filled by you, that from the fullness of our hearts, our mouth will speak. We surrender our mind, O God. Your word says that before a word is on our lips, you know it. You perceive our thoughts from afar. That's what you say. The Lord perceives our thoughts, and our thoughts become our words, and that is what defiles us. What comes out of us is what defiles us. Sometimes it's not so much the food. So may the Lord touch us, friends. May the Lord change us this Easter. May there be revival in our hearts. Revival on what we set our hearts on what we set our eyes on. Cleanse us, Lord, and we shall be cleansed. Oh, refine us, fire.
Choice.
It's a choice.
You,
it's a choice. you need to get off. Gossip contaminates, gossip defiles. Prayerlessness is pride. Some of us don't pray. We say we don't have time. But when we are called for money, we run. So we choose what to make time for. Prayerlessness is a form of pride, idolatry. Whatever is honorable, whatever is of good report, whatever honors the Lord, whatever glorifies the Lord, we set our hearts on those things. You have power to overcome cohabitation. You have power to overcome fornication. You have power to overcome adultery. You have power to overcome greed and corruption. You have power to overcome anger. You have power to have self-centeredness. We are so selfish. We are so self-conceited. We are so self-absorbed. But we have power to live for others. We have power to be reconciled. We have power to forgive. We have power to walk right. We have power to love. It's available. It's accessible. It's available. It's accessible, children of God. It's available in the Word. As we read the Word, as we do the Word, we access power. We access power as we read the Word and do it in the mundane things of life. Oh, hallelujah, Lord. We choose to do His will. We can choose. We can choose to be different. We can choose to be tender. Our hearts tender towards other people, tender towards our wives, tender towards our husbands, tender towards our children, tender towards the brethren, tender towards everyone. We can choose to access that power. When He left the grave, He said, "All authority and power has been given to me." And He gave it to us, all authority and all power. But we are sleeping giant. We have chosen the world. But don't you know that the love of the world is enmity to God? That's what the scripture says. We have chosen laziness. We have chosen the traditions of men. We have chosen complacency. We have chosen laziness. Friends, laziness is not our portion. The Bible says a lazy man is brother to a destroyer. You destroy destiny by being lazy. You destroy purpose by being lazy. I don't have power or energy to pray. I don't have energy to fast. I don't have energy to do what God called me. We are clothed with power. We can access divine strength. We can access staying power. We can access endurance. When the Holy Spirit is on the inside of us, He gives us enduring power. We can endure. We can persevere. We can stand. We are not feeble. We are not weak. We are not just a smoldering wick. We can be fanned into flames. We are strong in the power of the Holy Ghost. We are strong. Believers, stop making yourself babyish, immature, frail. Every time you're dying, you're fainting. Yet we have power, accessible strength, accessible joy, peace in the Holy Ghost. The Word of God is food to our bones, is food to our bodies, but we are too lazy to open the Word. We are too lazy to do the work. Today, we yambulo obugayavu. Tori mugayavu. I can't do an overnight. Man, I can't pray for 10 minutes. For me, when I pray, start yawning. You yawn. Hallelujah. We have power over sin. We are not prisoners of sin. Sin has been defeated. Amen. We can be holy. Our bodies can be blameless. We can be virgins till we get married. Don't believe a lie, the deception of this present age. The god of sex has taken over. And we refuse to be prisoners to sexuality. We can be pure because we have power, access to purity. We can be wise because the all-wise one lives on the inside of us. Amen. We can walk with fear and trembling, accessing the fear of God. We can. I'm not standing here telling you you're feeble, you're weak, you know. There is no you know. We are strong. It is accessible. Just access it. Reach out in faith. Reach out in practice. Practice the word of God. Practice the presence of God. Pray for courage. The disciples prayed for courage. We can stand persecution. We should stop compromising. We can stand. The disciples were persecuted. They came back and said, pray for us that we may have boldness to preach the word. Boldness can be accessed. Courage can be accessed. Strength can be accessed. Purity can be accessed. We have no excuse as children of God. Hallelujah. We have all said we are believers here. We have no excuse. We've been justified. Let's give the Lord a mighty hand of glory. Give him a hand of praise because we have victory. We have victory in the name of Jesus. Hallelujah. We have victory by the blood of Jesus. All of heaven is behind us. Amen. There is no feebleness in us. Hallelujah. There is no weakness. There is no laziness. There is no lack. The Godhead is on our side. The Holy Spirit sits on the inside of us. Out of our bellies flow rivers of living water. Hallelujah. We have life. Amen. Hallelujah. Oh, the Lord is good. Amen and amen and amen. Go home and be blessed. You're justified. You're sanctified. Glorified. Amen and amen and amen. May the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ and the love of God and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with us all, now and forevermore.